There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender.
So hello and happy Sunday. Hopefully everyone's doing well. I didn't realize this, but today is Palm Sunday. Yeah. Because when I said hello to someone upstairs and I said happy Sunday, and then they said happy Palm Sunday, and I was like, oh, okay. Yeah, so there, yeah. So Jesus triumphantly entered into Jerusalem, where he was also tried, and today we'll learn about crucifixion. So let's begin by opening our hearts in prayer. So wherever you are, let's bow our heads, and then I'll pray. Father God, we thank you for gathering us here at this Sunday worship service to honor our Savior Jesus and to remember your triumphal entry and your trial and your crucifixion, dying in our place where we deserved punishment. You took it all on your body. Lord, we thank you for this grace. And Lord, we thank you that we can all be here and serve and worship you together. Lord, please bless today's message by Mr. James. And I pray that you may fill this place with your holy presence and that the word of Christ may penetrate our hearts today, Lord. We thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Okay, thank you. So we're going to stand and we're going to sing hymn 124. Okay, thank you. So we'll have today's representative prayer servant come up, and it'll be Jose.
Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for giving us Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. Father, we are grateful for Jesus who overcome the injustice and false accusations in the illegal trials for the sake of redeeming us from our sins. Please help us to turn our hearts to you, turn it away from our sins, and to worship and honor you in all we do. Lord, we are also thankful for your blessing and mercy on our UBF ministry. Lord, help us to have faith in God that moves mountains and powers us to make disciples of all nations. Lord, help us to practice Jesus' forgiving love and build up loving spiritual communities. Lord, please bless us raising spiritual leaders among young peoples who live by the gospel faith and make disciples in their own generation. Please grant strength and good health to Pastor Ron Word as he leads our ministry. Lord, bless a shepherd, Philip, as he leads the Canadian ministry with God-given strength and wisdom. Lord, bless Pastor Paulus, keep him healthy and fill him with your wisdom and spirit to oversee our Humber ministry according to your will, along with GTA ministries. Help us to raise 12 disciples and 12 churches, and may we all work together with one spirit and heart for your glory. We also pray for missionary Maria, missionary Jackie John, and Mark for healing and full recovery from their cancer. Lord, as we gather here to worship you, bless missionary James to deliver your words powerfully. Lord, bless us to worship you with all our hearts, and may your name alone be glorified through our worship service. We pray all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay, so we're going to read today's passage, Mark chapter 15, 16 to 47, responsively. So I'll begin. Okay. The soldiers led Jesus away into the place that is the Praetorium and called together the whole company of soldiers. They got a purple robe and then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on him. And they began to call out to him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" Again, they struck him on the head with the staff and spit on him. Falling on their knees, they paid homage to him. And when they mocked him, they took off the purple robe and put his clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. A certain man from Cyrene, father of Alexander and Rufus, was passing by on his way from the country, and they forced him to carry the cross. They brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. Then they offered him mixed myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him. Dividing up his clothes, they cast lot to see what each would get. At 9 in the morning when they crucified him, the written notice of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." They crucified two rebels with him, one on his right, one on his left. Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "So, you who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, come down from the cross and save yourself." In the same way, the chief priests and the teachers of the law mocked him among themselves. "He saved others," they said, "but he can't save himself." "Israel, come down now from the cross, and we see and believe." Those crucified with him also heaped insults on him. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. And at 3 in the afternoon, just cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing near heard this, they said, "Listen, he's calling Elijah." Some ran, filled a sponge with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. "Alone, let's see if Elijah comes down to you." With a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. The curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion who stood there in front of Jesus saw how he died, he said, "Surely this man was the Son of God." Distance among them, when Mary, the mother of James, younger, and Joseph, Salome. In Galilee, these women had followed him and cared for his needs. Many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem were also there. It was preparation day, that is, day before the Sabbath, so evening approached. Joseph of Arimathea, a prominent member of the council who himself was waiting for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for Jesus' body. So we hear that he was already dead. Summoning the centurion, he asked if he was already dead. When he learned from the centurion that it was so, he gave the body to Joseph. Joseph bought some linen cloth, took down the body, wrapped it in linen, placed it in a tomb cut out of rock. Then he rolled the stone against the entrance of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where he was laid. Okay, thank you. So we will now have a special music given to us by Hannah Park. Okay, thank you. So we'll now have today's message given to us by Missionary James Lee.
Hello. Happy Palm Sunday, right? Palm Sunday. Yeah, the Easter is a week away from today. May God continue to bless us to prepare our hearts to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. So, title of today's I also thank God for Hannah's beautiful music. I can feel her beautiful heart love for God through her music. So title of today's message is Christ was crucified on the cross. Mark chapter 15, 16 through 47. Key verse is 15:34. So let's read the key verse together with the same kind of heart of Jesus. Let's read it together. Okay. At 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, really thank you for helping us to worship you today. You may really fill us with your presence, especially you may draw us to the cross of Jesus and newly put our faith in him and confess our faith to him through this time. You may guide us and keep us your word. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So from today, this 1 week is called Holy Week or Passion Week. So before the Easter Sunday. And Friday is the Good Friday when Jesus died on the cross. So without death, there is no resurrection. Jesus' death and resurrection are inseparable. Therefore, it is meaningful to think about the death of Jesus at this time. So why is Jesus' death, which happened 2,000 years ago, still so important to each of us? Why is it, how is it related to us today? These questions are what we want to focus when we think about Jesus' death today. Pilate, the Roman governor, tried to release Jesus, knowing that he was innocent. But the crowd shouted, "Crucify him!" Wanting to satisfy the crowd, Pilate released Barabbas, the insurrectionist, instead. Then they had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified. We know how cruel the Roman flogging is. We saw the vividly through the Passion of Christ, the movie. They used whips whose end had sharp metals attached them. By this time, Jesus was already exhausted by flogging, and his body was covered with blood. Look at verse 16. The soldiers led Jesus away into the palace, that is Praetorium, and called together the whole company of soldiers. Now Jesus was handed to the cruel Roman soldiers, who put a purple robe on him, then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on it. Blood was gushing out of his head, pierced by the thorns from the crown. Look at verse 18 through 19. And they began to call out to him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" Again and again, they struck him on the head with a staff and spit on him. Falling on their knees, they paid homage to him. The Roman soldiers mocked his kingship because Jesus was charged as the king of the Jews. Jesus went through unbearable pain and suffering in the hand of the cruel Roman soldiers who did not know what they were doing. Isaiah prophesied in Isaiah chapter 53 verse 4, "Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God and stricken by him and afflicted." This verse shows us that Jesus' suffering is redemptive. He did not suffer because of his own wrongdoings. He suffered in our places, taking up our pain and bearing our suffering. Look at verse 20. "And when they had mocked him, they took off the purple robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him." Jesus had to walk toward the place of crucifixion, carrying his own cross. But he was too weak and too exhausted to carry the cross. Look at verse 21. "A certain man from Cyrene, Simon, the father of Alexander and Rufus, was passing by on his way in from the country, and they forced him to carry the cross. We don't know much about this man, but we know one thing, that his life was changed when he encountered the cross of Jesus. He might have felt the most unlucky person at the time when he was picked up and forced to carry the cross. But his life was forever changed through this encounter of Jesus' cross. The fact that his name and those of his two sons are recorded in the Bible suggests that they became influential members of the early Christian community. Look at verse 22 and 23. "They brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha," which means the place of the skull. "Then they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. Wine mixed with myrrh was used as a pain-killing drug for those who crucified. They offered it to Jesus to numb his pain on the cross, but Jesus refused to take it. It is because he wanted to confront sufferings with a clear conscience. Last week, I did a biopsy due to my skin problem. The doctor injected a pain-killing drug first. Then I felt no pain during the biopsy. Then I began to think how painful Jesus would feel as he went through the whole process of crucifixion without pain-killing drug. But Jesus refused it so that he could take up all our pains and bear all our sufferings. When people confront pain and stress in life, they tend to escape it by turning to addiction, such as drugs, hard working, or computer games, or pornography, etc. But they can they can numb their sufferings temporarily, but do not solve their real problems. We must turn to Jesus, who bore all our pain and sufferings on the cross. Then there is healing and restoration and solution of all our problems, whether it is physical, mental, or spiritual. There is the precious fountain and the healing stream near the cross of Jesus. Look at verse 24. And they crucified him, dividing up his clothes. They cast a lot to see what each would get. Mark, the author of Mark's Gospel, described Jesus' crucifixion simply by saying, they crucified him. He did not need to explain, because at that time, everyone knew what it meant to be crucified. As we know, the crucifixion is the most cruel and painful way to execute a criminal. It was designed to maximize the suffering of the criminal until death. Look at verse 25 through 27. It was 9 in the morning when they crucified him. The written notice of charge against him read, the King of the Jews. They crucified two rebels with him, one on his right and one on his left. Jesus' hands and feet were nailed to the cross, and his body was left in the air. They crucified two robbers on both sides of Jesus, you know, to humiliate him as the worst of the criminals. The Son of God, considered equal with God, was humiliated to the point of the worst criminal in this way. Look at verse 29 through 32. Okay, let's read these verses together from verse 29 through 32. Okay.
They hit him in the head and hit him, so you who are going to destroy the temple, you did it in 3 days. Come down from the cross and save yourself. In the same way that the chief priests and the teachers of the law mocked him among themselves, he saved others, and saved himself. Let this God be the kingdom of Israel come down now from the cross, that we may see and believe.
Those who crucified with him also heaped insult on him. He saved others, but he can't save himself. It is a great insult, as well as a great temptation for Jesus. During the time of his arrest, Jesus said to one of his disciples, "Do you think I cannot call on my Father and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels?" He meant that he had enough power to save himself as the Son of God, but he did not use his power to come down from the cross, but stayed there to the end, you know, to save others and fulfill God's redemptive work. Thank Jesus, who did not come down from the cross, you know, to save us. It is a self-evident truth that we cannot save others if we save ourselves. Jesus said in John chapter 12, 24, "Very truly I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. Jesus proved this truth through his life and death. Many great people of God, including Dr. Samuel Lee and Mother Sarah Berry, also proved that this is true. This truth is indeed the principle of life. Though it is hard to be applied in our life. But it is truly a blessed life and the way to live a fruitful life before God. I am a very selfish person in nature. My blood and bone is selfish, so I cannot change myself. So it is not easy to do something for others. My wife knows it very well. My wife looks so happy whenever she does something for others, especially when she makes a delicious kimchi to share with others. But I am often troubled when I have to do something for others, even small things. But I am ashamed of myself when I stand before Jesus, who did not save himself. In order to save others, including myself, I thank Jesus who stayed on the cross to the end in order to save me from my sin of selfishness. May God help me to grow as a sacrificial shepherd for God's flock and bear the fruit of life among young people in campus. Look at verse 33 to 34. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. And at 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Jesus uttered seven sayings on the cross. We call them the last seven sayings of Jesus on the cross. First, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." Second, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." Third, "Woman, here is your son. Here is your mother." Fourth, "Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani." Fifth, "I am thirsty." Sixth, "It is finished." Seventh, "Father, into your hand I commit to my spirit." These sayings of Jesus well describe the meaning of Jesus' death on the cross. Today, we want to think about the meaning of Jesus' death based on the fourth saying of Jesus recorded in Mark's Gospel. Actually, Mark's Gospel recorded only this saying of Jesus. Look at verse 34 again. At 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Why did he cry out in such a way? Someone says that God did not abandon him, but Jesus felt that way because of his excruciating pain and unbearable sufferings. In fact, the truth is that God did abandon Jesus when Jesus was crucified. Jesus was indeed in the state of being forsaken by God until his death. So far, Jesus had endured all physical and mental sufferings on the cross, but he could not bear his spiritual suffering when his relationship with God is broken. It is unthinkable that this happened when we think about the relationship between God and Jesus. Once God said, "This is my son, whom I love. I am well pleased with him." As Jesus was coming out of water after being baptized by John the Baptist at the beginning of his ministry, we also see Jesus' love for God and his love relationship with God as the Father and the Son throughout his life on earth. Jesus was always sure of God's presence with him. He said, John chapter 8, verse 29, "The one who sent me is with me. He has not left me alone, for I always do what pleases him." Then why was Jesus forsaken by God? Why God had to abandon his own son? It was because of God's redemptive purpose, which means that he was forsaken not because of anything he did, but for the salvation of others. We remember when John the Baptist said when he saw Jesus coming toward him, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." And in the book of Revelation, Jesus was called the Lamb who was slain. Jesus' death is the death of the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of mankind, including each of us. When we read the Old Testament, we find the sacrificial system in the temple of God, which God provided for sinners to come to God and restore their relationship with him. It was through the death of animals, particularly lamb or goat. They were sacrificed for man's sin. And Leviticus chapter 6, verse 10 records that there was an animal who was chosen by lot as the scapegoat and sent into the wilderness for making atonement. All the sin of the people was placed on this animal. And he was not allowed to come back from wilderness and left there until death. In the same way, Jesus was forsaken by God on the cross for the sin of the world. He cried out, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" It was not because of his own sin, but for the sin of the world as the Lamb of God. We are the ones who should be forsaken by God because of our sins. But in his great love, God made his own son the Lamb of God, the atoning sacrifice, so that we could be saved and restore our relationship with God. We all experience the feeling of abandonment directly or indirectly in our life. And it leaves a deep scar or trauma in our hearts. How did God feel when he had to abandon his beloved son? How painful Jesus might have felt when he was forsaken by his father. It is beyond our understanding. Why did the father and the son have to experience such a broken relationship? But we know that it was all because of his love for us, for mankind, who could not but be abandoned by God because of our sin. But through Jesus' death on the cross, our sins are forgiven through the shedding of his blood, and our relationship with God is restored. This blessing is given to us through our faith in Jesus Christ. When our relationship with God is restored, our broken relationship with people also can be restored in God. Does any of us live in the feeling of abandonment? We do not need to live in that way anymore, because Jesus did not abandon us, but instead he was abandoned by God, you know, to restore our relationship with him. In this way, Jesus did not save himself, you know, to save us. Because of Jesus, we can now love others as well in our love relationship with God. Look at verse 35 through 36. When some of those standing near heard this, they said, "Listen, he is calling Elijah." Some ran, filled a sponge with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. "Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to take him down," he said. Even when Jesus was crying out to God for the salvation of all mankind, they thought he was calling Elijah. It shows the ignorance of mankind about God's love and his redemptive plan. Look at verse 37 and 38. With a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. Then the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. This curtain was the thick material that separated the holy place from the most holy place in the temple, which was the dwelling place of God. So this curtain symbolizes the separation between God and man. But when Jesus died on the cross, it was torn in two from top to bottom. Sin separated us from God. But it was not God who separated himself from us. It is our sin that separated us from God. And it is the burden of sin we must bear. But God took initiative by removing the curtain and welcoming us back to him through the cross of Jesus. Through Jesus' death on the cross, our sins are forgiven, and our relationship with God was restored. We thank God for his love for us, and we thank Jesus who loved us and saved us on the cross. Look at verse 39. And when the centurion who stood there in front of Jesus saw how he died, and he said, surely this man was the Son of God. This confession of faith did not come from the mouths of Jesus' disciples, but from the Roman centurion who carried out the execution and stood in front of Jesus and watched how he died from the beginning to the end. He could know who Jesus is at the cross of Jesus. He saw hope and healing and restoration in Jesus. God gave him faith to make a confession of faith. Jesus was buried in the tomb of Joseph Arimathea, Joseph of Arimathea prepared. But his death is not the end of the story. Jesus' burial set the stage for the greatest event in history, the resurrection of Jesus. Thank God for Jesus, who was forsaken by God, not to save us from our sins and restore our relationship with God. May God bless us as we come near the cross of Jesus. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for Jesus, who did not save himself, but saved us, even by being abandoned by God. Heavenly Father, you may help us to really accept this Jesus as our Savior. And also, we may come near the cross of Jesus this time of Easter. Thank you. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
So I cherish the honor of it cross. In my troubles at last I lay down. I will cling to the honor of it cross. Will it take it someday for a cause? So despised by this world as the wonders of creation for me. Only killed and all God, that is glory above, to bear it to the temple in. So I cherish the honor of it all. In my troubles at last I lay down. I will cling to the honor of it all. And it changes someday for all time. And all from it comes, stand with us to be bound. Wondrous beauty and sublime. To the cross and all cross, Jesus suffered and died.
Okay, thank you. So we'll now have our offering time. Okay, let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your word today and for teaching us how our Savior Jesus was crucified and forsaken by God so that we could be forgiven from our sins, Lord, and that the sacrifice once and for all could be made, Lord. We pray that we may continue to come to you and that we may lay down all of our sins at the foot of the cross where there is forgiveness, Lord. And I pray that you may receive our offerings as we continue to come to you with open hands and open hearts and a true desire to serve your ministry. Lord, please continue to bless and protect each and every person. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, thank you. So Pastor Paulus is going to give us announcements and prayer topics.
Hello. Happy Palm Sunday. Thank God for blessing our worship service and very powerful and graceful message by Mission James, and as I was actually whenever I hear others' message like Shepherd Joseph's message and Mission James' message, I all the time take a note and is so yeah is the yeah is some words right, from his message. For example, the he said in his message that we cannot save ourselves, but Jesus can save us. That word also, and also the last part, Jesus' burial is not the end. That's the basis for the resurrection, right? So, you know, I love to read, you know, the novels, you know, in the before the you know the novels. I'm you know novels, not just classic novels, Dostoevsky and you know and the like. But most novels actually not almost what almost 98%, I think so. The ending part is all tragedy, Shakespeare like that, right? And but it's sad, right? And like this, and sad, some died, like you know. But gospel different, right? Ending part is happy, really happy ending, you know, resurrection and and like that, right? So that really makes really the gospel story. Yeah, it is actually the God's story is very different from even the compared to the many stories told by other religions. It's very different. So in his message, Mission James also, the Jesus was forsaken because of my sin. Forsaken, we know the what the English word, right? The be abandoned, right? You know, and the forsaken. I don't know, in my life, humanly, right? My parents, even though sometimes life was tough and, you know, they quarreled like that, right? But I didn't feel that I was abandoned, forsaken by them, you know? I have many sisters, they loved me and, you know, like that kind of environment. But so yeah, it's not easy, you know, for me, okay, those who family broken, whatever, you know, it's, that's why. But yeah, it's the feeling of forsaken, abandoned, right? And it's Jesus, you know, he never complained, never said anything, right? Even when he was, but on that moment when he was forsaken, even for a while, because of our sin, he couldn't bear that, because he loved God, his God Father. And so he cried out, and so he thank God for Jesus. And Mission James confessed in his message, and he is the very selfish sinner, right? Sin of selfishness. But I think I'm much more the worst selfish sinner. Right? That's what I see. How do I know? I have a lot of proof. My wife is so, you know, known among many people, you know, very diligent, you know, working hard, and, you know. So, yeah, she really works hard, you know, doing this, that, and, you know, and even, you know, to the, and when I see it, to the point of exhaustion, right? But still she's working even almost midnight, every midnight, like that, right? But what do I do usually? I lie on bed, right? So her working really given me uncomfortable feeling, right? So, but I make excuse myself, right? Okay, if she asks me help, I will give her my hands for, but she doesn't, never ask me help. So that's a whole problem, not my not like the sin, the self-righteousness, the pride, even though I do not have many things to boast about, but the pride, arrogance, and the sexual, sin of sexual immorality is I meant, right, was deeply rooted in me. That is why these days my prayer topic is really whenever work and the Lord grow me in your holiness. And I have been praying for the last 1 year especially, that Lord, remembering the Moses Psalm 90, right? And I pray to God that, Lord, when I see any person, even on the street, whatever, Lord, help me to see them with Jesus' compassion. So I'm struggling this day, and confess that. When I see even woman, have compassion. Compassion is love, right? Bible says when Jesus landed and saw many people, he had compassion on them, because they were like sheep without a shepherd, like that. So please pray for me that when you see person, when I will see the person's soul, one person is, according to Jesus' word, more valuable, the whole universe, that's, you know, so 됐죠. I'm free. So I really thank God to today's passage in the Jesus crucifixion, and I felt my sin was really, you know, lifted up, and that the blood of Jesus, and I really thank God for that. So as Mission James said, that basis, burial, death is not the end. Is a basis for the, he died. Burial means he really died, right? Crucifixion, died, right? Then you said it's not end. We said his glorious resurrection, right? His, the angel said, don't be afraid. You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene who was crucified. He is not here. He has a reason. See the place, empty tomb, like that. That's my message. And yeah, so please pray for our Easter worship service next Sunday. And so my message also, pray for in the all the servants, all the music program, and also we may invite also our friends, and you know, and we also pray for ourselves to meet this risen Christ newly. From our hearts, and we will have also the Easter lunch together here, and so thank you, praise God. Okay. And another prayer topic, Easter worship service, pray for that, my message, and on the March 29, that's the Good Friday, we will, in our church, actually, that's a kind of our yearly kind of practice, actually. And we'll have, our church will have the Bible passage, the recitation kind of a meeting, kind of a small contest, what if there will be prize, and you know, and like that. But by memorizing this, wonderful Bible person. If you really read the memorize, it gives us such a joy, and you know, and the spiritual joy can experience. So please pray for that. We are gathering at 6:30 at the church. Have some pizza, whatever, some dinner together, and we'll have the recitation. In that way, we may prepare our hearts for the our Easter worship service, right? And teach about it. And Mission David, the UTM Humber campus, UTM campus fine work. And Mission Maria, you can pray also. Yeah, pray for whole health. All right. So with this, and we may have a personal kind of a silent time of prayer, listening to Lord's Prayer, and then I say the benediction. Thank you. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. May the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, Holy Spirit be with you always. Amen. Thank you. God bless. Thank you.